Hey guys, welcome to The Market is Open. So after Tesla stock ran up pretty big from the Q3 results, we started hearing reports from short sellers covering their shorts against Tesla. Now Jim Chanos was one of these, however, he came out a few days ago and said that it wasn't true. He didn't cover his short and Tesla is still his biggest and best short position. So let's have a look at what Tesla bear Jim Chanos has to say about Tesla. But before we start, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. We would really appreciate your support and remember to hit the bell button. You can also support us on Patreon and bonus points for that creepy pic and follow us on Twitter at The Market is Open. You should also have a look at our website, themarketisopen.com, where we actually have videos for this channel on the right and our main channel in the center. We have recent stock quotes and indices like oil and gold and even Bitcoin prices. Also, if you make multiple portfolios using the site, they'll appear on the left side for quick viewing. And you could submit news articles and up and down vote them. So let's start with Jim Chanos' first statement, which is that Tesla is his biggest and best short position. So I think it definitely could be his biggest, but I think calling it his best isn't really classifying it properly. Tesla stock has run up from the high $170 a share, and now it's at $336 a share just within the last 6 months. So I don't see how you can call that your best position, unless his other positions are just doing even worse than that. But for someone who has a big short position in Tesla, it sounds like this is actually his worst position, but maybe he's hoping that it will become his best position. So Chanos is well known for being very public about shorting companies such as Enron and WorldCom and other companies that were frauds and ended up effectively going to zero. However, he's been going after Tesla for as long as anyone can remember. But I think his short thesis must be changing. In June, he said that Teslas are poorly made, which he probably would still agree with, but it wasn't true back then. And now that Tesla is selling almost 100,000 vehicles per quarter, this isn't really a legit argument. We've even seen Bob Lutz, who was a big Tesla bear, comment on how well the quality is for the Model 3s right now. Also, sometimes it's hard to tell what these big hedge fund managers are up to because they usually come on TV and start doing interviews when it's good for them to try to knock down the stock price. So I wanted to start by looking through some of the principles that these are Jim Chanos's principles for, I guess, raising red flags for a value trap. Now, value trap companies normally look cheap, but still continue to go lower. So let's sort of look through Jim Chanos's lens at Tesla and see what we come up with. So one of the things he uses to spot overvalued companies is cyclicality. The auto industry is a little bit cyclical over multiple years and does have some seasonality during the year. But Tesla is small enough that I think even if there was a recession, for example, they'd still be able to sell cars because the market is still fairly large even during a recession. And the Model 3 may do well during a recession if it helps people save money relative to some other vehicles. Also, a car like the Roadster would actually do quite well in a recession, I think, because only rich people can buy it anyways, and the rich people are usually unaffected by recessions. Now, in terms of being overly dependent on a single product, are they overly dependent on the Model 3? I would say that they are currently. However, you can look at it the other way too, in that focusing on one product can also give you massive upside, kind of like the iPhone, for example, which accounts for more than 60% of Apple's revenue. That said, I think once Model Y comes out next year, you'll start seeing Tesla become more diversified within the auto industry, especially now that the Model 3 has also eclipsed Model S and X sales. Plus, they have a solar and battery business, which they expect to grow rather quickly now that they can start focusing on it. So I think that will further diversify Tesla from relying on this single product, which is the Model 3 at the moment. Another sign of a value trap, according to Chanos, is expectations driven by hindsight. So I think this one can work both ways as well. Like, track records are important. I actually think that this one works in Tesla's favor for two main reasons. One is that Tesla has a history of missing timeline expectations, although they always deliver or overdeliver on the functionality and performance that they say. But if everyone expects them to miss going forward, all Tesla really needs to do is hit their timelines and that will beat expectations. So I think it's a dangerous stock to short for that reason. The second reason is that Tesla has a history of innovation and building new products from first principles, as Elon says. So this is a good predictor of the future, that Tesla can continue doing this for automotive and for other industries as well. But at the same time, just because they have a track record of innovating doesn't mean they can't make a mistake when they're trying something new. The fourth item here has to do with like being a famous or popular investor. Like, people think that popular people will continue to always be right, but that could change. So for this one, like, sure, Elon is pretty popular because of his crazy ideas and his companies. This is a pretty big problem for Chanos with regards to Tesla. But I think Elon is popular because he changes the norm, pushes new technology and innovation. So I normally don't want to bet against innovative companies. I don't think that's a very good idea. Now, at the same time, I think that this Chanos principle is pretty funny because he's the one who's famous because of his fun and his calls on companies such as Enron and WorldCom, etc. So he falls into the same category of, like, don't just believe everything that people say just because they have a track record. Like they say in the industry, you're only as good as your last trade. In terms of cheap valuations using management's measures, I don't think Tesla's really putting out measures. They put out their own, they put out a whole bunch of metrics, and you can choose which ones you want to look at. Chanos did list four of them that he looks at, like cash flow and earnings and stuff like that. But I think it depends on how you interpret it. But at the same time, I think at the early stages of a company, I think they will focus on the positive things to sort of keep that momentum going. And once you get bigger, then people will really start looking at the financials. I think Chanos might be a little bit early looking at the financials before the story has really played out. And lastly, accounting issues. We've discussed some of these on our channel. Have a look at our Tesla currency analysis video because so far a lot of bears have been bringing it up. They think that there are accounting issues with Tesla, which we've shown is just a misunderstanding of how accounting works by the bears. Also, usually fraudulent companies would fudge the numbers to hide something at the company. Like Tesla would have to be pretty dumb to be fudging the numbers and still be reporting huge losses in like the past quarters. Also, they have a very real product, which makes it more difficult to be a fraud. Like, for example, if they said, oh, we're selling billions of Model 3s, and it turns out no one's ever seen one and there aren't any on the road, then it would be pretty obvious that that isn't the case. However, you are seeing them on the road, and you can go buy one right now, and so having a real product makes a pretty big difference to make sure that a company is real. So we're clearly seeing a giant shift as well in the auto industry, and I don't think Tesla needs to make up the numbers to help them out in that area. Okay, so from Jim Chanos' recent interview, I mean, this is a pretty funny quote. He says that under $200, that's under $200 for Tesla stock, everyone thinks the company is going bankrupt, including Elon. So that's pretty funny. Even Chanos points out that Tesla does have a lot of liquidity not to go bankrupt, though he did point out that even Elon has said that the company was weeks away from insolvency. I mean, Elon did say that after the fact, but clearly Elon and team were able to turn that around by, I guess, working twice as hard and delivering the Model 3. Chanos also says that this company, meaning Tesla, is an auto OEM and is trading at 6 to 7 times where all of the other auto OEMs are trading at. So now, because Tesla hasn't had a full year of profitability, I'm not really sure what metric he's talking about, since Tesla doesn't have a PE ratio yet, which is usually what we talk about when we compare where two companies are trading at. Either way, GM is trading at about 5 times earnings. So, I mean, he's saying that Tesla is trading at 6 to 7 times whatever GM is trading at. So 30 to 35 times earnings would make sense. But Tesla doesn't have that PE ratios and it's not trading at 35 times earnings. So that doesn't make any sense. However, 5 times earnings for General Motors is quite low. And Ford, it says 21 times earnings here, but it is because they took some loss. But normalized, Ford is actually trading around 7 times earnings. So, I mean, this actually reminds me of the airline stocks, which continuously had gone bankrupt in the past. And, I mean, hey, the auto manufacturers have been bankrupt as well, too. So they seem to be trading like airlines. Pretty much every automotive company went bankrupt except for Ford and Tesla. So Chanos is trying to convince you that Tesla is an OEM, an original equipment manufacturer, and it's not like a tech company as people say. So my tech is, like, you can call it whatever you want, like tech or auto. It doesn't really matter what the sector is. It's sort of the growth trajectory that people are going to be using to value the company. And Tesla's growth rate has resembled companies mainly found in the tech sector. But at the same time, I also think that almost every industry or company will eventually have to sort of become a tech company. Otherwise, they may not survive. They'll just simply fall behind if their competitors are using technology and they're not. So we can have this whole debate thing about Tesla being tech or auto. Like, you can ask yourself, is Apple a tech company? Because, I mean, they sell phones, which is hardware, and they do manufacturing. I mean, they outsource it, but they also do retail and marketing and offer services. So you can argue that Apple is a tech company because they write software and make hardware for the communications industry. I guess Tesla sort of does the same thing for automotive, and so far their software far outpaces any other automaker. And since software is one of the key differentiators, people are probably going to switch away from other automakers to Tesla in order to have a better experience. So I also think that Tesla is the one causing General Motors and Ford and the other 100 automakers to have these low multiples, because they're shedding light on the fact that they're all outdated and old-fashioned, and they sell gas-guzzling vehicles, which are a thing of the past, and Tesla is supposed to be represent the future. So it makes sense that Tesla is crushing these other guys' multiples if you think that Tesla will replace other players. So if you look at it, if you look at General Motors in a vacuum, it shouldn't have a multiple of 5x earnings. Like, he's right. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, he doesn't even talk about General Motors, but he is talking about other car companies having a low PE ratio. So I agree, it doesn't make sense. But once you consider Tesla, and also like what we saw during the recession, that it doesn't really take much to wipe out General Motors, then you can see why people may be worried about GM and probably some other car companies too. Like, GM barely made it out of the recession. I mean, they didn't make it out, they got bailed out. And they were too big to fail, and they have these dealerships and these pension plans to worry about. So like, that was sort of round one, and GM got a second chance to reinvent themselves, but now it's going to be round two. Elon says he's been studying the blade, meaning he's been working hard while everybody's been asleep at the wheel. So when there's a fight, Tesla might have a bit of an advantage. So sort of to continue with this idea here, Chanos is saying that most OEMs trade under 5x enterprise value to EBITDA. And of course, Tesla doesn't. So, I mean, he's saying that Tesla must be an OEM. However, none of the metrics we use match what OEMs trade for, but they should. So I'm not sure that this is even, that makes sense. Like, maybe you should stop comparing the two. It's really apples to oranges. One example is that Tesla has no dealerships, and I think that alone makes it a fairly different company from these other type of automotive companies. Like, think of all the salespeople that Tesla doesn't really need at all. They have one salesperson who's at Tesla, which is Elon Musk, but everything else is mainly done online. So that's just one example, but you probably shouldn't be applying all of these traditional models of automotive businesses to a company that doesn't really fit those models anymore. But anyways, enterprise value over EBITDA is less than 5. Like, that's nothing. That's just something he made up. It's completely meaningless as far as I'm concerned. It's like kind of like saying the number of wheels to the number of potatoes is the traditional metric we've been using for hundreds of years. Okay, so enterprise value is normally used if you want to buy out a company. It's the market cap plus the debt. That's plus the debt. And you also want to subtract the cash. So clearly something you learned in business school. So basically, if I wanted to buy Tesla, I would have to pay the market cap, and then once I bought it, I still owe the debt. So technically, I'm paying the market cap plus the debt because I still owe that portion as well. And I can also subtract the cash because I can use it to counteract the debt. I can take Tesla's cash and pay off part of the debt. So that's what enterprise value is, but I don't think it's the right metric to look at for valuation of Tesla. Also, EBITDA, which is earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization, leaves out a couple important things, such as interest, taxes, depreciation. Like, do you pay interest on your credit cards or on your loans or on your mortgages? What if I just completely ignored all of the interest in taxes that you were paying, which is a pretty real expense? It also doesn't take into account depreciation, which is usually a byproduct of capital expenditures. So that's a pretty big problem with this metric, which actually seems to reward companies that spend more money, which I think is wrong. So if you're capital efficient, meaning you can build a 1,000,000 car per year factory, let's say for $10 at the extreme, that would be amazing, and you would have no depreciation but gigantic profits. But if you take the same company that's able to build the same factory but for $10 billion, well, like, your earnings are going to be just as high. However, you're going to have to depreciate that $10 billion over time now, which is going to be an expense on every single income statement. However, looking at EBITDA, we're just going to completely ignore that. So I don't think that's correct as well. Clearly, a company that's very efficient with its capital and a company that's not should be valued differently. So, and the less than five thing, that's just maybe a pattern that he's noticed among automakers. So I don't really think that applies to Tesla. But I think it makes sense why he thinks the company is worthless, is because these metrics are kind of worthless. Okay, so he says all those metrics, you run them through the global valuation models for an auto company, and you get a stock price that's interestingly worthless. It's zero. So that's what Jim Chanos said in this recent interview about Tesla. And I think that's why he needs Tesla to be an auto company for this to work. He also needs his metrics to be correct for this to work as well. But interestingly, Tesla happens to be worth $60 billion. So clearly there's a misunderstanding here. Either investors are wrong, which they've been known to be, or Jim Chanos is wrong, and he's been known to be wrong as well. So let's not focus on the actual valuation right now, but it's probably Tesla's probably not worth zero, as he's saying, especially at the current time where they seem to be growing and ramping up. I think this may stem from either a lack of understanding from Chanos's part on how technology works, or a lack of open-mindedness in trying to figure out the future. If you only focused on the financials, and Chanos is a financial guy, then you'd sort of miss the entire story, the technology and all the innovation that's coming out of Tesla. It really doesn't show up at all in the financials at this time, because the financials simply don't predict the future. So I don't see any evidence that Chanos has any understanding of technology. He rarely talks about the technology side of things. And so far, there is a lot more evidence that backs up the fact that Tesla is much better at software than the rest of the automotive industry. But there's no innovation line item on the income statement to show that. Like, one idea to sort of think about is Apple is a tech company. It's considered a tech company. And it has the financials. It has like $250 billion in the bank. But if Microsoft had like the actual iPhone killer and was about to destroy the iPhone tomorrow, you wouldn't see that in the financials at all. So I think the financials are only half the story. And at this stage in Tesla's business, they just need to have enough liquidity to keep moving along, which they have. And now let's see if their technology grabs people's business, which so far Tesla has been pulling away a lot of business from other auto manufacturers. Chanos goes on to say that actually Tesla was correctly early, but the problem now with Tesla is the competition. Porsche has the Taycan, which is an amazing car. So that's what he said. So first of all, I don't think the Taycan is actually that amazing. The specs are worse than the high-end Teslas, specifically the Model S. And the Taycan starts at $150,000. So I don't think it's going to touch Tesla at all. I think it's actually going to be the opposite. When the Tesla Roadster comes out, it's going to destroy this thing completely. But this is like a typical competition is everywhere type story that Chanos is talking about, which I've already said, flooding the market with other crappy cars isn't going to defeat Tesla. It's also not just the car, it's the business model and a whole bunch of other things. Like superchargers and whatnot, but like nobody wants to buy a car from a dealership either, for example. And to paraphrase Chanos, actually, this is sort of like having an asset, which is really a liability, and I'm talking about the dealerships. So that's something he actually criticizes Tesla's lease solar panels for, but I think it's going to end up being a bigger problem for all of the auto manufacturers, which have to deal with the dealerships, and Tesla isn't going to have that problem. So these are some of the main questions or concerns that Chanos has brought up in a recent interview. So North America demand is plateauing. Is that even how you spell plateauing? The first one sounds like the scariest of problems that all the bulls have just ignored from the Q3 call, but Chanos has figured it out. I think he's comparing a quarter where 100% of Tesla sales were going to North America, and last quarter, which Tesla was delivering vehicles worldwide. So Tesla as a whole appears to be supply constrained on the Model 3 in Q3. So I believe demand should be fine, and I don't think this is a real problem. The second thing, gross margins in Shanghai are going to be no better than Fremont. This one is exciting to me because, I mean, it was asked on the call as well, not by Chanos, but by some other analysts. Won't the China car be the most profitable one ever? And Tesla said to use the same gross margins as Fremont. So either Tesla is planning to lower the price or something in China over time and sell more cars for the same margins, but that doesn't actually seem to be the case. They're actually selling the car at $50,000 in China, which is a little bit more than they're selling it in Fremont, but because of the tariffs and stuff, it's actually a lot less than they were previously selling it for. The other option is maybe the China Model 3 costs more to make than we think, and Tesla was lying or something, but I think this is unlikely because they've already told us how much they're saving on the factory itself, and we know that labor is cheaper in China, etc. I actually think that they're setting expectations to be low, and either way, this might probably be end up being a positive. So Chanos is like, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this business in China if it's going to be the same margins as Fremont? There's a lot of head scratchers here, he says. But like, even at the same margins, it would still be an excellent business. Okay, the third thing, he's puzzled by supplier changes. He says that Tesla lawyers have figured something out because they've added a table into the financial statements. So I think like Tesla has increased transparency, and he says, well, therefore they must be hiding something. So I think that might be overthinking it. Also, I don't care about this at all. Like, who cares if Tesla fires all of their suppliers tomorrow? Like obviously they have the most insight into what needs to be done from a supplier perspective. So I'll let them figure that out on their own. The fourth thing he wants to know is, why are all the executives leaving? In my opinion, for one thing, executives happen to cost a lot of money. You can hire a whole bunch of engineers in exchange for one of these executive salaries. So I think Elon looks at the business from like a "are you carrying your own weight" perspective and a cost-cutting point of view. But at the same time, there's also that story with Steve Jobs where he gets into an elevator with an employee and asks them like, "What are you working on?" And by the time the elevator reaches the next floor, the employee is fired. So I think Elon might be like that as well. Like, I think he's very difficult to work for. He works a minimum of 80 hours per week, and I think he expects his employees to do the same. So I mean, working there is not for everyone. And if he's going to change things up also at the C level until he's happy, I think he has the right to do that. So even with all of these executive departures, Tesla seems to be functioning quite well, at least from the external perspective that we know about. Finally, Chanos asks, what is gained by missing these pronouncements? So he's referring to vehicles like the Semi, which he believes should have been out by now. Like, why tell everyone and then miss a deadline? And that's his argument. So, I mean, he is right. I would like to see Tesla move deadlines forward, like with like what they did with the Model Y, which has been unheard of for Tesla, and still hitting those deadlines that have been moved forward. So that's still yet to be seen. But a lot of other companies do delay things that aren't ready. I think Tesla has just done it so many times that some people hate it and some people are just used to it already, and they sort of factor that in. And I think that's an important thing to do, specifically because Elon has told us that he's not good at predicting when these new products and things are going to exactly when they're going to come out. That said, I think Tesla is working their fastest, but they've also learned a lot from their mistakes with the Model 3 factory, for example. So it is difficult to predict something that's never been done before. But again, it seems that Tesla always delivers or over-delivers on what they say. It just comes possibly a little later. However, that does affect the valuation. Say something growing at 50% per year, 5 years out, that may be a meaningful amount of money, and bringing that in a year earlier adds more profitability and delays competition. But at the same time, anyone copying Tesla will likely run into these same delays as well. So overall, I think that if this is his bear case, it's a little bit weak. It focuses on current and historical financials, which for a company racing to get out new technology, doesn't really seem to be a great tell of what the future is going to hold. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. Let us know what you think in the comments section below. Remember to smash that like button and also hit the bell button if you're thinking of subscribing to our channel. Thanks so much for watching.